So today's topic is OSI model. So let's start. What is OSI model? It is a conceptual 7-layer framework. It is a concept only. That's why we use the term conceptual. It describes a universal set of rules, means protocols and requirements in order to support interoperability between different products and the software. So what are the features of OSI model? OSI model characterizes computing functions of networking communication in a 7-layer framework. These 7 layers are application layer, presentation layer, session layer, transport layer, network layer, data link layer and physical layer. Each layer is a set of protocols, means set of rules. Each layer deals with some specific functions which are required for networking communication. The top three layers are known as the software layers and they deal with the software specifications or protocols. Next layer is the transport layer. It is the heart of OSI model and responsible for end-to-end delivery. And last three layers are known as hardware layers and these layers deals with the hardware protocols and specifications. At sender side, data flows from application layer to physical layer. And at receiver side, data flows from physical layer to application layer. So now let's discuss each layer one by one. The first layer is application layer. This layer directly interacts with data from the users. And this interaction takes place using some software applications like web browsers, email clients, FTP clients, telnet. So the next question came, are the client software applications make part of the application layer? No, these client software applications are not part of the application layer. In fact, these software applications rely on application layer to initiate communication. So what is the role of application layer? Application layer is responsible for the protocols and the data manipulation so that the client software uses them to represent meaningful data to the user. Next question, what are application layer protocols? So mostly used application protocols are HTTP. All of us are using web browsers for web surfing. And HTTP and HTTPS are the protocols which are widely used in web surfing. Next is SMTP. This protocol is used for email communication. FTP, file transfer protocol to transfer file between client and servers. The email protocol, telnet and many more protocols are used as application layer protocols. Let's take a graphical example of application layer use. Suppose there is a user and he wants to serve a website. When he types the address in Mozilla Firefox or any browser, the browser application pick appropriate protocol using application layer. It may be HTTP or HTTPS. While at the server side, application layer decide at which port data has to be sent. For HTTP, port 80 is used and for HTTPS, port 443 is used mostly. In the same way, if we are using an email client to send the mail, then the email client software will pick appropriate protocol using application layer. And this protocol may be SMTP or POP at client side. At server side, application layer decide which port has to be connected for email communication. And this port for SMTP is 25 port and for POP port 110 is used mostly. So this is the example of how an application layer is used in real world scenario. Next layer is the presentation layer. Presentation layer takes any data transmitted by the application layer and prepare it for transmission over the session layer. While at the receiver side, reverse will take place. It takes data from the session layer and prepare it for application layer. So the main task is the preparation of data. To prepare this data, presentation layer performs three main tasks: translation, compression, and encryption. So let's take an graphical example. Suppose from application layer a data is received. Data is ASDF 45678. This data is not understandable by a machine, so it is translated in a binary or machine code. After translation, this data is compressed to reduce the bandwidth requirement. Again, after compression, data is encrypted to ensure the data security. After encryption, this data is sent to the session layer for further processing. At receiver side, the reverse will take place. It will receive data from session layer, then de-encrypt it. After de-encryption, decompressed, and again it is translated so that user can understand this data. Next layer is session layer. Session layer performs three tasks: authentication, authorization, and opening and closing the session, means session management. So what is authentication? Authentication is a process that checks who are you, means what are your credentials. In this process, we have to provide your user ID and password. When you provide user ID and password, session layer passes this data to the authentication server. Authentication server checks ID and password. If these ID and password matches with records, it will send a success message to initiate a session. Next process is authorization. Authorization is a process that checks what you can access and what you can do on access resources. Let's understand this. After user authentication, the server check which file and folders and other resources can be accessed by the user. And once he got the list of these files and folders, then server checks what operations on these resources can be performed by the user. For example, suppose a file ABC can be accessed by the user. What operations user can perform on this file? These operations are read operations, these operations can be write operations, these operations can be a delete operation. So this process is known as authorization. After authorization, session management takes place. What is session? Session is the time between when the communication is opened and closed. Session layer ensures that session stays long enough to transfer all the data being exchanged. Means, suppose there is a file of 1 MB, then session layer ensures that session stay long enough so that these 1 MB file transferred successfully from source to the destination. Next, after transfer or after the operation, it will promptly close the session in order to avoid wasting of resources. After session layer, the next layer is transport layer. This is the heart of OSI model and responsible for end-to-end communication between two devices. It takes data from session layer, breaking it into the chunks called segments before sending it to the network layer. And this process is known as segmentation. On the receiving side, device is responsible for reassembling the segments into data chunks so that session layer can consume this. Next most important function of transport layer is the flow control. It is a set of procedure that determines an optimal speed of transmission to ensure that a sender with fast connection does not overwhelm a receiver with a slow connection. Let's understand with a graphics. Suppose there are two networks, network A and network B. Network A has receiving speed 10 segments per second, while network B has transmitting speed 20 segments per second. So, if there is no flow control, what will happen when data is transferred from network B to network A? Let's see. You can see half of the data segments lost because of the slow receiving speed of network A. So when flow control is applied, network A sends signal to network B when to send the data. And in this way, the network A and network B are synchronized and data loss is eliminated. This is the role of the flow control. The next function of transport layer is error control. On the receiving end, transport layer ensures that the data received is complete or not. If not complete, then request a retransmission of missed segments. After transport layer, next layer is the network layer. And this is the first layer of hardware layers. The network layer is responsible for facilitating data transfer between two different networks. Please note the term between two different networks. Suppose there are two networks, network A and network B. Network A is using different standard, network B is using different standard, network A can have a different IP plan than network B. So, in this case, network layer is responsible for the facilitating data transfer. What if two devices communicating are on the same network, then network layer is unnecessary. Suppose there are two devices on network A and they want to communicate, then there is no role of network layer. Network layer breaks up segments from transport layer into smaller units called packets and resembling of these packets on the receiving device. So let's take help of a graphics. Here you can see at transport layer, data chunk is converted to segments, and at network layer, these segments are converted to the packets. While at the receiver side, packets are again reassembled to segments, and these segments are reassembled to data chunks at transport. Next layer we will see in next slides. Network layer also find the best physical path for the data to reach its destination, and this process is known as routing. The device that perform routing known as router. Layer 3 switch is the advanced form of LAN switches, and they also perform the routing, and they are also layer 3 device, means network layer device. Next layer is data link layer. And this layer is responsible for facilitating data transfer between two devices on same network. Please don't confuse between data link layer and network layer. Network layer is responsible for data transfer between two devices on different networks, while data link layer is responsible for facilitating data transfer between two devices on same network. Let's take an example. There are two networks, network A, network B. For data transfer from network A to network B, we need network layer. But for data transfer between two devices on network A, we need only data link layer. Network layer is not required. So, this is the basic difference between the network and data layer. Data link layer take packets from network layer and break them into smaller pieces called frames. Again, we refer the last graphics. Here, data link layer is shown and it converts packet to frames at the sender side and receiver side. These frames are reassembled to the packets. Data link layer is also responsible for flow control and error control in intra-network communication. These functions are also performed by transport layer. What transport layer perform these functions for inter-network communication. Inter-network communication means for different networks. Switches and bridges are data link layer device. Data link layer is handled by NIC, network interface card, and device drivers of the host machine. After data link layer, the next layer is the physical layer. This layer defines the characteristics of the physical equipment and media involved in the data transfer, like cables and switches. At this layer, data gets converted into bit stream, which is a string of 1 and 0. At physical layer, both devices must agree on a signal convention so that ones can be distinguished from zeros on both devices. Hub, repeater, modem, cables, all are these physical layer devices. Functions of physical layer includes bit synchronization. Physical layer provides the synchronization of bits by providing a clock, and this clock controls both sender and receiver, thus providing synchronization at bit level. Bit rate control means it defines the transmission rate, means the number of bits sent per second. The next function of the physical layer, it defines the physical topology. The physical topology means the way in which different devices or nodes are arranged in a network. For example, it may be bus, star or mesh topology. Physical layer also defines the transmission mode. It defines the way in which data flow between the two connected devices. The various transmission modes possible are simplex, half duplex or full duplex. So friends, this is the brief discussion on the OSI model. If you found this video useful, please subscribe and like my channel. Thanks.